Hillary has been lengthening her excuses as to why she lost the election. She didn't really lose the election. It was stolen from her by, I think it's up to 24 different excuses she has now. Number 24 is content farms in Macedonia. And as I said, my grandfather was a Macedonian content farmer. And we often think about, you know, gathering on the porch and recalling the old days on the Macedonian continent. He never thought that the old content farmers he left behind in Macedonia would one day steal the U.S. presidential election. They are gnarled.
And welcome to this year-end edition of the Macedonian Content Farmers Podcast. My name is Jason Miko, and I am coming to you from rain-soaked Oral Valley at the foot of the Catalina Mountains in southern Arizona. It is Wednesday, December 26th, the day after Christmas that has been celebrated largely by Catholics and Protestants, Boxing Day in the UK, St. Stephen's Day, amongst others. My co-host is?
This is Cvetin Chilimanov. I'm coming in from Skopje, which is unusually clear this evening. We also had some rain and some wind, and that's the best thing we can get here to clean up the atmosphere. It's about almost 10 in the evening here in Skopje, and it's been quite an eventful year, week, and even the last few hours have been pretty packed, but we'll get to all of it.
Yes, I've been following Twitter. I've been at home all day today, had a lot of family celebrations yesterday and Christmas Eve and the day before and whatnot. So today I've been just kind of catching up on things and just following the Twitter feeds, Twitter feed, Svetin. It's been there's just a lot going on, and I know that we this is an end of year podcast. We want to kind of do a very quick recap, and I think the best way to do the recap of what has happened in 2018 is at the beginning of January 2018, Zoran Zaev, the installed Prime Minister of Macedonia, insisted that the Constitution of Macedonia would not change in his pursuit of a name change deal with the Greeks, and here we are at the end of 2018, and the there has been amendments galore that have been passed at various levels. I know they have one more vote in the middle of January. Mm-hmm. We've got amnesty galore. We've got tax issues. Taxes are being raised. We've got tariffs on aluminum and steel in Macedonia. We've got all kinds of things that are going on under the Zaev regime, which has been in power now for a year and a half. And everybody said that things would get better once Zoran Zaev and his government were in power.
Yeah, right.
A year and a half later, and we have essentially chaos, as in the words of Peggy Noonan, not only is the trolley off the tracks, but the wheels are off the trolley. What's going on?
Yeah, he just at this point we're basically assuming that whatever he says, the opposite will happen. So yesterday he said he will not run for president. So now we are all gearing up for the comical and inevitable presidential run of Zoran Zaev, which he assumes will save him from future criminal charges and investigations. Just today, his spokesman was saying we are not proposing a new amnesty law that will let all of these Vemera horrible people out of the hook. And sure enough, by the end of the day, they began the process of adopting just such law. So yeah, it's really fun.
So you're saying there's a second amnesty on the table now, is that correct?
Oh, yeah. I was making a Mexican-style empanadas a little while ago, and I was just thinking about how you should never, you know that saying about sausages, you should never know what goes into your sausages or empanadas.
You should never watch laws on sausages being made.
Absolutely. But they're so hapless, they're so, disorganized, we basically get a ringside view of their laws being made and their sausage being made today, and it was glorious. They introduced one version of the law, then they withdrew it, introduced another. I think they were up to three versions, and all the while there was new rounds of chaos and anger and depression on Twitter and on their by older supporters of the SDSM government, who were until recently happily shouting, "No justice, no peace, we'll get them all in prison. Sita ke ležita," this, you will all be lying in prison, rotting in prison. And now all of a sudden the government, it adopted one amnesty law for the members of parliament who were charged with terrorism over the April 27th incident in the parliament. And now they haven't even processed this part, and now there is a new law which will make it much easier for you. You know, it will reduce the mandatory sentences for people charged with abuse of office. And this covers literally everybody they need in parliament, like Kanchevska-Milevska, like Zikir Remčulovic, like, you know, this horrible case of this lady member of parliament whose son has been sentenced to 3 years in prison over alleged abuse of office. And in order to vote to change the constitution and to turn Macedonia into North Macedonia, she says, "I demand an amnesty law for my son," obviously, like any mother would do. And now she's going to get this. And this flies in the face of everything they said about rule of law, you know, accountability, putting in prison high-level government officials. It's glorious. It's a complete derailment, as you said.
Yeah, well, actually, I think we kind of take a step back and remember that the April 2017 charges against the folks that were in parliament, they were charged with terrorism. Essentially, as Solzhenitsyn writes about, Article 58 of the Penal Code of the Soviet Union, quote-unquote, wrecking, which was basically a made-up charge in the first place. And so we see people like the opera singer. Yeah, exactly, yeah. So we see, so under this amnesty law, we see people like the opera singer, Igor or Drlosky, who is refusing to take part of that because he rightly asserts that he was wrongly charged in the first place, correct?
Absolutely, yes. Charged with terrorism, an opera singer for singing the national anthem at a peaceful rally, which only turned violent when SDSM and DUI provoked the masses, knowing full well what's going to happen.
And besides Igor, who else has refused to ask for amnesty, Cvetin?
Well, the first one out the gate was Jane Cinto. You know, he's the grandson of Metodi Andon of Cinto, this heroic figure from World War II who was sentenced by the communists because he fought for a Western-oriented Macedonia, not a communist Macedonia. He, you know, defiantly said, "I'm not taking amnesty from basically from as soon as this law was announced." There is, and today the two of them, they're joined by the former interior minister Mitko Chavkov and another police official who is also charged alongside Chavkov. And there was another person, Igor Yuk, who they tried to pressure to say all this, you know, nasty stuff about, I guess, I don't know, the President Ivanov or Nikola Gruevski or whoever. He also refused, and he also refused to claim amnesty. So we have five persons who are essentially political prisoners at this point, dissidents against this government, and who refused to be to bear false witness, or who refused to snivel and bow before Zaev, and they are not going to use the amnesty law, even though it will clearly apply to them.
I think rather most Macedonians, because they were wrongly charged in the first place, and now they're not taking advantage of this quote-unquote amnesty law. I've even seen a few social media references to perhaps Igor's name being thrown in there for the presidential race, which is coming up in April or May. What are you hearing on that?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I mean, as soon as he announced, he wrote this Facebook comment saying, "I will not ask for amnesty, I will not snivel before these people." And then he posted Sid Vicious's My Way, his version of My Way.
My Way, you mean the My Way, the Frank Sinatra song, My Way?
Yeah, but it's not exactly the same in the Sex Pistols rendition.
I can imagine, yeah.
There are some differences. And I mean, obviously, he's now easily the front runner if he decides to run. We have to read up on whether a person who's in prison or either sentenced or charged can run for president. But you know, right now, if he wants it, he'll have it. And obviously, there are other candidates.
Well, I think either way, you know, leading up to the presidential elections, let's just assume for now that Zoran Zaev gets his way and he pushes through the name change, the constitutional change, the change, the identity, language, culture, history, everything. who, if you're going to be in the middle of presidential elections come late February in Macedonia, the candidate supported by the majority of Macedonians, I believe, by Vumaro de Famine, is going to be running around the country talking about Macedonia and the Republic of Macedonia and the Macedonian people and Macedonians living outside of Macedonia in Aegean Greece and Bulgaria, etc. And then you're going to have the citizen candidate or the citizen Dewey candidate, whatever that is they come up with, talking about North Macedonia and refusing to talk about Macedonians living abroad, even not even wanting to talk about. It's going to be a stark contrast between those two candidates or three.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I think another important issue is going to be how they position themselves regarding the Prespa Treaty, if it survives until April next year, whether to what extent the candidates from the opposition are going to call for its annulment or we will not implement it. We do not recognize the way it's being passed, pushed through Parliament. There is now talk that SDSM and DUI may try to protract the elections, maybe deliberately boycott them after they had boycott used against them in the referendum. And then under their explanation or understanding of the constitution, it would mean that Talat Jaferi is all of a sudden the acting president of the country, and he will sign everything. And then they have completed their obligation and they walk away scot-free. Again, it's very important to see how the Greeks will see this, because this entire contraption already has so many legal flaws in it, like the failed referendum, like the arrested, detained, blackmailed members of parliament who vote for it, clearly still demanding amnesties on top of amnesties. The president will not sign it, so somebody, Talat Jaferi, who was himself not legally elected as speaker, may sign it, and then there will be no UN Security Council resolution. So it's up to the Greeks whether they will accept this kind of contraption as binding on our part, irrevocable on our part, before they give us their accession for accent for our NATO membership, which is obviously irrevocable once they give it. So,
and of course, we might see early elections in Greece as well. I know they're supposed to have elections in September. That would be 4 years. There's talk about doing them in May in combination with the European Union elections. But as we know, Panos Kamenos, the defense minister and leader of the independent Greeks, junior partner in the government with Alexis Tsipras, is very clearly against the so-called Prespa agreement. And he doesn't want to bring the government down, but he and his coalition and others perhaps would definitely vote against it or not even vote at all, withholding the votes from the prime minister. So there's all kinds of moving parts in this sad affair, shall I say, going on with Macedonia and Greece, as well as others. But one thing I don't think we'll see, Cvetin, I don't think we're going to see a whole lot in the new year and as we move forward, I don't think we're going to see a whole lot of a parade of international characters coming in like we saw this fall with especially with our outgoing Minister of Defense, or as we say here, Secretary of Defense, Jim Mattis, who is departing next week.
Yep. Oh, that was great.
And
the image of him landing in Skopje Airport, and there were so many high-level visitors like Angela Merkel and Mogherini and whoever coming, so the guards couldn't keep up with rolling the red carpet, rolling it and unrolling it again. So Mattis is, you know, this Marine general, this mad dog person who threatens people, they're going to, you know, I pray I don't have to kill you. Character, and he's walking down the stairs of the airplane, and our soldiers are still sweeping the red carpet and still gluing it in places. It was amazing. And then now he gets the broom. We use the term here, mitla. He got the broom from President Trump.
Right. Now, of course, I'm an American citizen. I have enormous respect for James Mattis as a member of our military. You know, besides his nickname as Mad Dog, he also has another nickname, by the way, called Warrior Monk, believe it or not. And I think he's a fine American, a true hero. I thought it was interesting in his resignation letter to President Trump that he mentioned that we need to be very respectful of allies. And I completely agree with him on that. What I find ironic, of course, is the fact that the United States has not been respectful of certain allies like Macedonia. And now Mattis was probably going in at the behest of the State Department, the Obama State Department, and others into Macedonia when he came in this fall and said, "You've got to pass a PRESPA and whatnot." But he's absolutely right. In order to maintain our alliances with our friends and allies in other countries, we do need to respect them, and that would include Macedonia and letting the Macedonian people make their own decision.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this was completely embarrassing. It was the low point of the Trump administration's approach toward Macedonia. We were honestly hoping that they will turn the page, as opposed to their treatment of Macedonia during the Obama era. This clearly hasn't happened, and you know, it was heartbreaking to have Mattis here and disrespect us in this way and tell us, order us to change our name, even though the United States recognized Macedonia under this name in 2004 in exchange for our loyal partnership and being loyal allies to the U.S. at a time when very few countries would join the U.S. in military engagements abroad. So, but again, with his removal and obviously with the removal of Ambassador Baily from Skopje, there is again some hope that the page will be turned. Let's maybe take a short break here and we can get back to Ambassador Baily after the break.
Sounds good. Content Farmers Podcast. My name is Jason Miko. I am joined by my friend in Macedonia, Cvetin Chilimanov. Cvetin, it is a little after 2 p.m. here on Wednesday the 26th. The storm clouds are still rolling over the Catalina Mountains here as I look out my window. I am enjoying a lovely glass of Tikvesh Rakia, which I picked up the last time I was in Macedonia.
And I took your advice. I'm doing mastika now.
But because it looks cold outside, actually because it is cold, look, I'm a desert rat, and it's 10 degrees outside, 10 degrees Celsius, about 50 degrees Fahrenheit. So to me, that's cold. So that means I need a little bit of rakia instead of the mastika today. But before we went away to the break, we were talking about the American ambassador, Jess Baily, who will be leaving soon. I think everybody will be able to rejoice when he is gone from Macedonia, and when he is gone. And you can interpret gone however you like. What do you know on that end?
Well, I have my cell phone ringtone ready for this occasion, and I had it ready for more than a year because he's been leaving this country since forever. It's the man who never returned. You know this great Boston song, and there is a glorious version in what was that? In Malcolm in the Middle, when the father sings this song with a group of his friends, and it's just, you know, hopefully he never returns, or anybody like him. But given the state of U.S. diplomacy and the State Department, we can hope to be so lucky. But more importantly than his departure is that the wheels appear to be coming off of his insane clown posse car that he's been driving around. Seems that there are problems in his entourage of people who have been so willing and so eager to jump at his every wish and fulfill his every command in the judiciary, in the media, in the police and elsewhere. And we had this extremely curious development today that a news site, which is extremely close to Jess Baily and the U.S. Embassy, publishing the information that he sent a letter to all the judges in the country, to the Supreme Court, to the very important the criminal court in Skopje, which is, you know, punishing, you know, going after all the Vemera people in the country. He sent this to the Judicial Council and elsewhere to complain that for some reason, judges were using his good name and saying that when they order detention against a Vemera official or order, a lengthy prison sentence based on inadmissible evidence, illegally wiretapped conversations against another Vemera official, they've been saying for some reason that this Jess Baily told us to do this. You know, it's not my fault, I'm very sorry, but the U.S. ambassador makes me do this. And now Jess Baily tells them, whatever gave you this impression, and it's completely false, and please stop doing that, and I never told you to do this. And it's incredible.
Well, we have some friends on Capitol Hill in the House and the Senate, I'm sure, that would be interested in that. I'm sure Judicial Watch would be interested in that. Well, I'd love to see that letter.
Oh, me too. It's not officially confirmed until it has been officially denied. And today, Jess Baily officially denied that he has been meddling, poking around in our judiciary. And even though for the past several years, it was not only clear from his part, but it was very clear from media close to him and from the judges themselves that Baily, David Stevenson, the departed political affairs officer of the embassy, who has now moved in the NGO sector in Macedonia apparently, and is allegedly advisor to Zaev and the special prosecutor, Karanakova, another advisor in the embassy, that they are the ones who are preparing the sentences against Vimmer officials so as to remove them from public life, so as Zaev can have, the clean runway to land his North Macedonia Express plane onto it. And still they are unable to do this, and still this is open abuse and meddling in our political affairs, putting good people, decent folks in prison, destroying their lives, turning significant portion of the country, easily the majority of the country, against the United States, to the point that I'm not sure if we'll be able to salvage US-American, Macedonian-American relations after what Jess Baily had done to us. And all of a sudden, you know, he's been bragging that he has invested, I'm making scare quotes with my fingers, tens of millions of dollars in the Macedonian judiciary until yesterday, literally. And today he says, what, me? Judiciary in Macedonia? No, never heard of her. I don't know about Judge Kacarska, never heard of her. And he has been whining and dining the special prosecutors in the embassy, which was clearly an indication, we support these people. We support the politicians who come to our events. You know, Stevenson would go to prosecutorial and judicial seminars in Ohrid, and he would say, this is what needs to be done, in no uncertain terms. And now all of a sudden, as we say, they just fell off Mars. They are completely surprised and they're washing their hands. I know this is the Christmas season, not the Easter season.
But they're clearly trying to wash their
hands. Thank you. Thank you, Pontius Pilate.
But they're clearly trying to wash their hands.
Yeah, two points. For a moment there, you said David Stevenson had departed, and I got quite excited. I thought he had departed the planet, which would be better for all of us. But too bad he's still...
We haven't seen him in a while, so...
Right, yeah. But the second thing is, and I've been saying this and writing this for quite some time, Cvetin, is that, all of the parties, certainly Citizen and Vumra de Pamene, we know what the Albanians are going to do. But regarding the American ambassador, the ambassador from the UK and other Western ambassadors, for way too long, party leaders have been running to the ambassadors every time that they want something or need something, and they shouldn't. These are men and women, just like you and me. They put on their pants one leg at a time. They drink the same Coca-Cola that we drink. They are human. They are fallible. In some cases, they are more fallible than most people. A lot of them have huge egos, and there's absolutely no need for the political class in Macedonia to be running to the ambassadors every time they want something or need something or want to get back at the other side. I say, you know, the ambassadors are supposed to be representing their own country's interests, not interfering in Macedonia. And every time that the political class runs to one of these ambassadors, it empowers them. And I say, forget it. Just ignore them as much as possible.
Yeah, but it got the politicians appointed prime ministers and interior ministers, etc. So, and sent out of prison, even though we had, you know, reams of evidence against them. So yeah, this is how it works.
We beat up on Jess Baily enough right now.
Yeah, well, not nearly enough, but yeah.
Not enough. Okay.
let's shoot off. I'm going to shoot off a few short points of news which might be interesting in the future, and then we can maybe go to our Farmers Picks. Recently we had Bulgarian President Rumen Radev saying that he's opposed to Macedonia changing its name to North Macedonia, which shows us two important things: that this thing will never be over, and another that this thing is driven by domestic considerations of both Greece, Bulgaria, Serbia, Albania, etc. So Radev is now challenging Boyko Borisov. He's a socialist, former Air Force general, closer to Russia, obviously, than Borisov is. So he's now challenging him on a primary nationalist issue, which is now, which is the Macedonian issue becoming in Bulgaria. We had, yesterday we had Speaker Talat Jaferi. Now, obviously, members of parliament, they're feeling that they're not going to be re-elected, many of them, if not most of them, in the next parliament. So they're now, they're seeing their colleagues from Vomero getting huge payments if they switch sides to vote in favor of amending the constitution and renaming Macedonia, etc. So they want theirs. They want something more. So they're now proposing a law that they will get, they can retire at 50-something.
Bloody hell!
And they will get picks of the choiciest, juiciest, plushest government job if they're voted out of parliament, etc. And Talat Jaferi was asked about this, and he said, well, you cannot expect a member of parliament, like, if he, when he, his four-year term expires in parliament, that he will go dumpster diving, and he literally used this word. They have feathered their beds for the next three generations, and they're still complaining about, well, we will starve if we are voted out of parliament, God. And then we also had this excellent indication of how highly the European Union values Zoran Zaev, because they're actually going to slap tariffs on our steel and aluminum exports to the EU, which could cost us as much as 200 million euros. So here we are giving away the family jewels, changing our name, giving away the nation state which we have, and you know, naively hoping that this is going to lead to some prosperity and, you know, a payout of infrastructure funding, if not less. And no, they have to slap tariffs on us, and they're going to put as many as 20,000 people out of business.
And wow, that's incredibly sad. It's wrong. It's and you know, Zaev has said that as soon as he gets done raping Macedonia of its name and identity, he's going to focus on the economy, and apparently he's going to rape that as well. Not only the EU and, as you mentioned, the steel and aluminium, as our British friends say, producers in Macedonia, but of course the government is going to introduce scrap the flat tax, which has been very successful. Not just in Macedonia, but around Europe. We would love to have a flat tax here in the United States, but the government's now going to scrap the flat tax and introduce progressive taxation, despite the fact that the entire business community in Macedonia, the Chambers of Economy, the American Chamber of Commerce, Macedonia 2025, and others have said this is not the right way to go about it. This is wrong.
Yeah, maybe the American Chamber of Commerce can ask Baily to bring Grievski back.
Yeah, well... So that's what we have to look forward to, I guess, in the new year, is that not only a change in Macedonia's name, identity, constitution, language, heritage, culture, etc., but a wrecking of the economy. Well done. Well done. Bravo, Zoran Zaev.
Yeah.
Well, let's move on to the more pleasant topic of our farmer's picks after a short break.
Charlie's wife goes down to the Scully Square station every day at 2:15. And through the open window she hands Charlie a sandwich
as the train comes rumbling through. Woo,
woo. But did he ever return? No, he never returned. And his fate is still unlearned.
He may ride forever.
He may ride forever neath the streets of Boston. He's the man who never returned.
May that banjo Steve-O.
And welcome back to the Macedonian Content Farmers Podcast. Jason Miko and Cvetin Chilimanov. And we've come to that time now where we've got our farmer's picks. Cvetin, tell us about your farmer's picks.
Well, I think we struck gold the last time when I was reading sorrowful, pitiful, angry, disturbed tweets from Macedonia over the first amnesty we had. And now, lo and behold, we have more of those. So we had a number of angry pro-SDSM tweeps comment that now that they have to apply for amnesty over the April 2017 parliament incident, one of the former Vimera members of parliament, Krsto Mukovski, that by mistake, instead of applying for amnesty, he again reapplied for another government contract, because on top of demanding amnesty, he had his brother apply for a very sizable government contract to maintain publicly owned real estate across the country. And he, you know, surprise, surprise, he won it. It's worth nearly 700,000 euros.
Wow.
And the cherry on top, it was approved. You know who is a co-manager of the public institution which manages publicly owned property across the country? Lyubomir Frychkovsky's son. The hideous former Interior and Foreign Affairs Minister who wrote and then rewrote all our constitutions. His son is now managing public property. It's in safe hands, be assured. And he's now giving hundreds of thousands of euros in government contracts to the brother of Krsto Mukovski at a time when Mukovski is expected to vote in favor of amending the constitution and renaming Macedonia. It's great.
Nice year in bonus.
And then we have Pravedna Tavita. She's a Twitter commentator from the right. And she says, well, you know, never mind Mukovski. Zaev applied for amnesty as well, by mistake, even though he's not charged, because he has been pardoned God knows how many times so far for petty crime, for serious crime, and now he's, you know, let's, just to be on the safe side, let's apply for this thing as well. And then we had a typical, you know, disillusioned, naive commentator is Jovana Tozia, who wrote, well, everybody told me nobody's going to go to prison. But no, Jovana, you have to be optimist, and you have to be repeating on and on, they will go to prison, they will go to prison, we'll put them all in prison. And, you know, expletive deleted in the end. So this is what's happening in the Twitterverse with the second amnesty now. But enough about Macedonian Twitter. Jason, what are your favorite picks?
Well, Cvetin, a great question. It is Christmas time. We just had Christmas here yesterday. I know Macedonia celebrates in about 10 days, 11 days. We have New Year's in between, so I think this is appropriate. My farmer's pick is not Macedonia-centered per se, but it is a beloved Christmas classic. The book A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens was first published on December 19, 1843, which was 175 years ago, and it has continuously been in print since then. It's been translated into hundreds of languages. I'm not sure if it's in Macedonian. I hope so, because it's a wonderful book. There have been numerous film adaptations, live action, as well as a cartoon. My family gets together every Christmas and watches the 1970 version, which is called Scrooge, with the British actor Albert Finney, and it's actually a musical. But there's two quotes in there I just want to leave our listeners with. And if we can find the audio to those, we're going to insert those in here. So the ghost of Christmas present confronts Ebenezer Scrooge, and he says two things which I think are just prescient. Number one, he says,
there is never enough time to do or say all the things that we would wish. The thing is to try to do as much as you can in the time that you have.
Yes, but
remember, Scrooge, time is short, and suddenly you're not there anymore.
The second quote is one that I always end with on my my weekly columns, and that is,
there are more good things in this life, Scrooge, than you can possibly imagine.
And I think both of those quotes are important to remember. There's more good things in this life you can possibly imagine, no matter all of the bad things that are going on in your own life, in your country, around the world. But then the one about time is that there's never enough time to do or say all the things we want to do or to say, and that time is short, and we have got to try and do as much as we can in the time that we have. That is my farmer's pick for this podcast and for the end of the year.
Well, this was a lovely topical way to end the podcast. Let's wish all our listeners, all 50 of them, maybe, Happy New Year and Merry Christmas, of course, again. We have another Christmas upcoming, according to our calendar. And yeah, maybe we can end this up with a song.
Well, yes, Cvetin, always great talking to you. A happy new year to you and your family. Happy new year to our listeners. And yeah, let's end this podcast on an upbeat note with a little musical song from the 1970 version of Scrooge, I Like Life.
Ebenezer Scrooge, the sins of man are huge. A never-ending symphony of villainy and infamy, duplicity, deceit, and subterfuge. And no one's worse than Ebenezer Scrooge. Though man's a handy candidate for hell, I must admit, life sometimes has its brighter side as well. I like life, life likes me, life and I fairly fully agree. Life is fine, life is good, especially mine, which is just as it should be. I like pouring the wine, and why not? Life's a pleasure that I deny not. I like life here and now. Life and I made a mutual vow. Till I die, life and I, we'll both try to be better somehow. And if life were a woman, she would be my wife.
Why?
Why? Because I like life.
That's all very well for you, but not for me. I hate life.
Nonsense, man. Why?
Because life hates me, that's right.
Scrooge, you're an even bigger fool than I took you for. I've never heard such a lot of self-pitying drivel. You don't even know how to live. Now you listen to me. I like life. Well, go on.
I like life.
That's better. Life likes me.
Life likes me.
Good, good. I make life a perpetual spree.
Perpetual spree.
Eating food.
Drinking wine.
Thinking who'd like the privilege to dine me.
I like drinking the drink I'm drinking.
That's better, Scrooge. I like thinking the thoughts I'm thinking. I like songs, I like dance. I hear music and I'm in a trance.
Tra-la-la.
Oom-pa-pa.
Chances are we shall get up and prance.
Where there's music and laughter, happiness is rife.
Why?
Why? Because I like life.
And laughter, happiness is right. Why? Because I like life. See how much we like life.